Kevin Gray, I'm the Family Support Coordinator for the Alzheimer's Association. I coordinate our caregiver support groups in the Bay Area, including Solano County. And also do a lot of educational trainings and some other stuff that I won't bore you with. But I'm here today to talk to you about personal care, tips for providing care for your loved one. How many people here are caring for somebody with Alzheimer's disease, specifically? Okay. Or a dementia. I mean, okay. Or just memory problems, not sure, and I just need more information. Perfect. So today we're going to talk about. I can take this off, right? I changed my mind. I want to walk around.
Heather, maybe.
I got it.
You okay?
So for today's little training, we're going to talk about ways for you to assist your loved one in grooming tasks, dressing. How many people have problems with their loved ones and dressing? Grooming. You just keep your hands up, right? What about bathing? Or concerns that you're going to have to be doing these things as the disease progresses? How many people are scared? How many people are, I can't believe I'm doing this? Okay, you're in the right place, right? You're among your peers. So let's talk about some grooming issues that come up for somebody with Alzheimer's disease or related dementia. You know, we all have our own personal taste, our own personal preferences, what we, how we wear our hair, whether or not we wear our makeup, what kind of clothing style we prefer to have. I prefer to be in flip-flops, but I have my girl shoes on, right? I prefer boots over heels because I'm a klutz and I can barely walk as it is, so I don't need 3-inch heels. I'm almost 6 feet tall as it is. I don't need to be 6'4". But we all have our own taste, right? So it's one thing for us to kind of, our taste kind of changes over time, right? My mom used to wear heels. She doesn't wear heels anymore now that she's retired, right? She doesn't need to anymore because she's not working. And she's so much happier. She's got like 15 pairs of Skechers. I don't even know what you do with 15 pairs of Skechers, but she's got 15 pairs of Skechers and tennis shoes and kicks, right? And she doesn't wear her suits anymore. She wears her sweats or she wears dresses or skirts, but she's more casual than she was, right? And she loves it, right? Her style's changed primarily based on her retirement, but our styles will change as we get older as well. What happens for somebody with Alzheimer's disease or related dementia, their style of preference is gonna change, right? And this could be clothing, it could be hair, it could be facial hair, right? So a lot of times what happens as caregivers, we struggle in trying to maintain what the person might have wanted to look like or looked like 15 years ago, right? So maybe they always got their hair done. Maybe they always wore makeup. Maybe they always wore a skirt and heels and pantyhose. Maybe they always wore a 3-piece suit. And they would never want to wear sweatpants. Right? How many people are going through this right now, are thinking about this piece? How many people are still trying to dress their loved one the way they dressed 15 years ago? Oh, good. Right? Because their styles change, and it becomes harder for them, right, to be able to maintain their own bathroom experiences. It's harder for them to even maintain the cleanliness of their clothes when they're having problems eating. Right, so as the disease progresses, we have to adjust our expectations of what we want the person to look like. Right? It's easier to pull down sweatpants than it is to unbuckle suspenders or unzip pants or take off pantyhose. I have enough problems taking off pantyhose, right? Trying to take off somebody else's pantyhose becomes a lot more difficult. Right? So we have to adjust what our expectations are from a person as they progress through the disease. So some general grooming tips for you is you want to keep it comfortable, right? Comfort is key, and routine. You can use people's favorite toiletries. You can use simple grooming tools. You can apply this to bathing as well. I have 3 different conditioners in my shower, 2 shampoos, 1 soap, 2 body spray things, right? I have apricot scrub. I got a lot of stuff in my shower, right? Do I use those things every day? No, right? And I probably haven't used a scrub in like a month, but I like having it in me. It's a pretty complicated routine, right? On Sundays, I do a facial, a quick little facial that costs 99 cents, right? But I have a ritual, right? But it's complicated. When we're dealing with somebody with this disease, we have to think about simplifying some of these routines, right? So maybe we have 1 shampoo, right? Maybe we have 1 conditioner. Maybe we have 1 toothpaste kind or 1 toothbrush sitting out for that individual. Simplification is easy. How many people have a loved one that's still able to groom themselves and doesn't need assistance? How many times have you noticed them standing there not knowing what to do when they're in the bath, right? It's because there's too much noise in the environment. There's too many things to distract that individual, right? So there could be toothpaste on the counter, lotion, hand wash, maybe you have a soap, maybe you have more toothbrushes, there's 4 toothbrushes, and they don't know which ones to use. So they're becoming more confused in the bathroom. So if you limit the noise in the bathroom, you might be able to see that they'll be successful in their grooming rituals, right? Maybe you lay out a towel, a toothpaste, the toothbrush, and put it on the counter for the person, and then they're able to brush their teeth. Maybe you take out everything from the shower or the bathtub, hopefully it's the showers, and they don't have to step into the bathtub, but everything but their items when they're wanting to bathe. So then they know whatever they grab, that's gonna be the right choice for them. So simplifying it and limiting their choices will be very extremely helpful. If you're having a person that still wants to brush their hair, you can use a bridging technique. And the bridging technique is really, it was really you kind of demonstrating what to do and telling them what to do, right? So we'll say, I'm going to use Tom as an example. He doesn't have a lot of hair, but come on, Tom. Surprise. Yes. I have to pick on Tom, our IT guru, right? So if I was asking Tom that we had to get ready, right? We have an hour to get ready, when we're talking about the time frame. But we have an hour to get ready, and Tom is still brushing his hair, right? Or is capable of brushing his hair. But he's getting stuck, right? I would go up to him and say, hey, Tom, or honey, sweetheart, you know, can you brush your hair for me today? Right, so I'm mimicking what I want him to do. I might even take his hand with the brush in it and say, can you brush your hair for me? And allow him to do it for himself, right? Does that feel good?
Yeah.
Okay. Shh, don't tell his wife. She loves me though. So your love will be holding whatever object that they have, the toothbrush, the hairbrush, even the fork. This could be at during dinner time or during breakfast time, that you're mimicking the gesture or you're actually following through with the gesture with them, holding the hand. Why don't we eat our soup or pick up the fork? Doesn't mean, I just want to be very clear, doesn't mean that your loved one will know the name of the object, right, will understand what a brush is, right? But that doesn't mean that you don't call that object by its name, okay? It doesn't mean that they're going to retain the information and go, oh, it's a brush. But you can still call it by its name, by that object's name, as long as you're bridging the using the bridging technique. All right, do you have any questions around bridging technique? I saw your hand up. So you have a fear of removing items from the bathroom, or concern that your mother is going to ask you where are those things once those items are removed, because she's misplaced a lot of things.
Yeah.
So I would say you should try removing a couple of items and see what happens. And the worst case scenario is that she's looking for something and she's able to name that item that she's looking for, and then you say, oh, you know what? I think I forgot to put that in the bathroom, and then hand it to her. And then remove it again. Right? And you can use this technique with dressing in your closet. I'm probably going to be skipping some slides because I'm talking about it now. But you can use this technique, not the bridging technique, but the removing, making things disappear, making it less of a clutter, right? So you can see the person still dressing, that they might have problems or it might take them longer to get dressed in the morning. And part of that might be because they don't know which item to wear, right? I stood in my closet for 5 minutes this morning going, okay, what's clean, right? And what am I going to wear? What's going to match? Or what's appropriate for me to wear to today's conference, right? Person with Alzheimer's disease is going to have a much harder time making a choice in what article of clothing that they're going to wear. So if you limit the article of clothing, if you remove all the winter stuff now, right? You're not going to have to worry about them breaking out the big bulky sweater that they clearly don't need in Solano County right now, right? That if you limit all the suits, right? Things that they're not going to wear on a regular basis, you're going to make it a lot easier for them to be able to do these things for themselves. You know, so the point really is around personal care is that we want to allow the person with the disease to remain as independent as possible and be able to do things on their own, knowing full well that we're probably going to have to set up things to make it less distractful for them and easier for them, right? And so it comes back to, well, if they ask for that item that you made disappear, you give them that item and blame yourself, right? Oh, I forgot to put it in it. Here you go, right? Because that clutter is going to cause them to lose concentration and not know and not be able to complete the task. That was a good question. Good luck. You get distracted. I mean, I get distracted. We all get distracted, right? It's easy to get distracted. You're listening to me, but you're probably thinking about, oh, it's getting kind of late. I don't want to take a nap. I just had lunch. Oh, what are we going to cook for dinner, right? But you're still kind of pretending to listen to me, or at least you look intentful, right? And then you bring it back. But what happens for you is that you bring it back to the task at hand, even though you might be thinking about 10 or 15 different things, right? The person with the disease is not going to be able to bring it back, right? They're going to get distracted by some shiny object, and that's all they're going to be able to focus on. And they're not going to be able to backtrack. Or if they are able to backtrack, it's a lot more difficult for them too.
I just
want
to ask really quick, what I'm going through right now is my husband wants to get his haircut. He looks at himself and he's like, look at this hair of mine, it needs to be cut. And then when I say, okay, let's look at the haircut or whatever, but he doesn't want it. So I don't know how you get around that.
So the question is that her husband wants to get his hair cut or thinks he needs a haircut, but by the time that you go to get the haircut, he doesn't think he needs it anymore. So if that's a pattern of behavior, my question is, do you think he needs a haircut?
Yes, because he's cutting it himself.
Oh. How bad is it? It's bad. It could be a new fashion trend, right? Yeah, you know, I think there's two things that happen when the person is attempting to participate in their own personal care, but also needs assistance outside of that. I would try to remove scissors from the bathroom, right? So that at least he knows that he wants to get his hair cut, but you have the tools available to him for him to do it himself. Right? So if you remove the tools, at least he's not going to be able to go do it. And you can say, oh my God, I forgot that we need to get new scissors. You know what? I don't have time. We can do that later, but why don't we just go to the barber? Right? And then you can do that again the next time. And then the next time. Right? So you want to utilize your little figlets, a lot of arsenal of like, oh, oops, I forgot. Or, oh, I don't know where that is. Let me go find it. Right? Even though you know clearly that you're not going to A, you're not going to do it, they're not going to do it, right? And B, that by maybe an hour or two later, they're going to even forget what they even asked you about, right? So redirection can help, but I'd probably say remove the scissors, right? Because you want to think about safety as well, right? So if you do have items in the bathroom or in the kitchen that they're, or even in their in the garage or if they have a workshop, you want to start removing some of those things. I would say don't remove everything at once, but gradually start removing things, especially around safety issues, right? Because we don't want him to accidentally cut his skin, right? Because at some point he might not know how to use the scissors. Is that helpful? Yeah, so purchases of items that they're not going to use or probably don't know how to use. Well, Home Depot's a pretty great place as far as they'll take returns, right? You can, if your loved one is going to the same store all the time, most stores kind of can keep track of customer purchases. Most of the bigger stores, especially if they have a credit card at that store, I'm assuming your husband was a contractor there, he probably has some type of account. Just return the items, right? It's frustrating, it's annoying, but it's not the end of the world, right? There's a lot of things for you to worry about, but there are certain things that are just annoying that can be dealt with. And that's probably one of those things. Kind of back to like the grooming and the dressing and the hair care things is that some things are, again, annoying and frustrating. It doesn't really matter that his hair is kind of, I don't know what it looks like, but it's not what it should look like, right? That piece is not the end of the world. What would be the end of the world is if he took those scissors and hurt himself, right? So, if the person's wearing mismatched socks, but they were able to get themselves dressed in the morning, not really the end of the world, right? Or they come out with a Hawaiian shirt and checkered pants, and you're going to church, right? But they were able to pick out their outfit and dress themselves, and you didn't have to do it, you shouldn't care. Right? So sometimes our own personal preferences hold us up. Right? Because we place expectations on the person with this disease that they're not going to be able to fulfill. And then we get disappointed, then we get angry, then we get frustrated, then we feel guilty, and then we get angry with ourselves. Right? It becomes this vicious cycle. Right? So there are certain things. You can have your pet peeves, you know, it has to be this way, but you want to limit your pet peeves to at least three, right, that you will fight the person with, right? No, they always have to have their shoes on or their slippers on when they're walking around the house. I need them to have their shoes on, right? Okay, that's fine. But if that's the case, there's going to be a point where you're going to have to put their shoes on all the time because they're not going to be able to do it. Right? And then you can't complain about it. Right? Right? And then you let all the other stuff go. You don't care about the Hawaiian shirt or the checkered pants at church. Right? You don't care that, oh, they let the washing machine finish the cycle. Right? And now I have sogging clothes in the dryer. Right, that's typical. Or they're washing the dishes, but they're not really washed, and they put it back in the cabinet. Right? Those are annoyances. Not the end of the world unless you've chosen that to be your pet peeve. So, shaving, again, this is around safety issues. Electrical razors are a lot better than, my brain just turned off.
Straight razors,
or disposable razors. Is that what they're called? Straight razors, disposable, same thing.
Same thing.
They're easier for the person to manage and maintain. I would probably say maybe they do their shaving in the bedroom than rather the bathroom, because you don't want the razor to fall into a sink that might have water in it. But if you still want, if the person still wants to shave, then you want to allow them to do that, but in a safe environment. You also want to think about using a comfortable chair for the person. So maybe they're not standing anymore. Maybe the person has a little balance issue, so having a place for them to sit. Some of these things don't have to be done in the bathroom. Right? Shaving doesn't need to be done in the bathroom. Brushing one's hair doesn't need to be done in the bathroom. Even brushing one's teeth doesn't need to be done in the bathroom. Right? How many people have gone to the hospital and had to brush their teeth in the bed and use a little spit thing?
Yeah.
Right? So we have associated certain rooms in our home for specific activities. Right? I eat in my bedroom or eat at my desk, right? But there's lots of people who are like, no. You have to eat at the dining room table. We all need to eat together, right? That's fine, right? But not every room is really designed for that specific activity. You have assigned importance to that room. So again, you want to make it comfortable, but you want to make it easy, and you want to think about, hey, you know, maybe I don't need to have them brush their hair in the bathroom. They can sit there in the living room and brush their hair. Not really the end of the world, not ideal, but doesn't really matter as long as they're doing that activity for themselves. If you are thinking about, hair care, and the person's having problems washing their hair in the bathroom, or you're having problems during bathing time, washing their hair. You can also think about taking them to the barber or the hairdresser once a week or twice a week as an excursion. I know, Nat, did you take your wife to the hairdresser? Because you were having problems with...
No,
you told them the situation, and she enjoyed it. She enjoyed going, but it was one less thing that you had to try to convince her to do, or that you had to do on your own. Yeah, so a lot of times, I'm going to get into bathing, but a lot of times the bathing and the washing one's hair in the bathtub or in the shower is a battle. How many people have a battle? Right? Or they come out half clean or somewhat clean, right? So you want to think about workarounds around that. And the barber and the hairdresser is a good workaround, because at least you know, okay, they're going to get their hair washed, right? And it's going to be good. And then you can battle the rest of the kind of maintenance issues. Do your loved ones have podiatrists? Has anybody seen a podiatrist? For foot care and nail care, I have a woman, her husband goes to a podiatrist, but he also gets pedicures now because she was worried about his toenails. He was getting some fungus on his toenails, on his feet. And so she started taking him to her salon. She gets her nails done, and he gets a pedicure. He loves it. He just falls asleep. So that's also a way for them to bond, but also something that she's also getting something for herself at the same time. But nail care, fingernail and foot care are extremely important. They're not able to trim their nails, use their device. It could be they forget how to do it, or they have limited flexibility to be able to bend over and cut their toenails. So scheduling an appointment with a podiatrist is good. Talking to the podiatrist about can I take them to a nail salon for just regular maintenance. That's if the person can stand being scrubbed and, you know, because I kick and scream, but I get my toes done because it's so ticklish. So let's talk about dressing. So has anyone's loved one walked into church with a Hawaiian shirt and checkered pants? It's going to be the new style. About the dressing? Preserving one's dignity, that you want them to kind of maintain their appearance prior to their diagnosis, is your question. I rephrased. But that, so the question is, if the person is walking into church with the checkered pants and the Hawaiian shirt, and you know that they would be mortified showing up that way, what do you do? And then, because you want to preserve their dignity. My question back at you is, okay, how much effort and trouble is it for you to dress them the way that you think that they would want to be dressed? If you feel that there is, it's not really, there's no skin off your back, it's pretty easy, they're pretty compliant, it's not a problem, I'm able to get them to the bathroom and get their clothes, you know, and they're able to use the bathroom on their own, I'm helping them with this. I'm assisting them in that, and it's not a stressor for you. And I said, okay, go ahead and do it. My point is, it becomes increasingly more difficult to preserve that dignity, take care of yourself, and allow them to be independent in the bathroom. Does that make sense? Sometimes, so that's why I said, if that's your pet peeve, like the dressing, is like, nope, they have to be meticulous, that's just the way it is, that's fine. But maybe you have to let some other things go. Like, for example, I don't care about the dishwasher and cups going in the wrong place when they're putting away dishes. I don't care about the room being a mess. Or whatever it is, some of those other pet peeves have to be let go. Because you can't stress about every little thing. But what I find working with families is maintaining this level of what they were like before becomes increasingly more challenging for you. It becomes increasingly more stressing for you, right? Because what tends to happen is the person with the disease will show up to church looking meticulous, and then you show up to church looking haggard, right? Because you just spent 3 hours trying to dress them. Right? And then your own self-care goes down. But if you're able to maintain both, by all means, I'm offering you an option out. Because at the end of the day, if they're able to dress themselves, good on them. Right? They're able to do these things on their own. That's great. That's kind of maintaining their own dignity. They picked out their clothes. They were able to put their clothes on themselves and get ready for church. That's a positive. That's more important to me than what the actual item they picked out. Now, I want them to go to church with clothes on, right? I also want them to go appropriately dressed for the weather, right? And so I will remove whatever winter items are in the closet and limit the options in the closet so that they don't get confused when they're getting, lessen the confusion while they get dressed. Was that helpful? You're still going to dress them to the tens, aren't you? Yeah. I'm fine with that. Standing there for 3 hours, you can put two items on the bed for them to choose, and they're items that you're perfectly fine with. Like, so you can create the environment to influence them doing what you want, but there'll be a time when that might not work anymore. So I'm giving you another option of, you know, are you going to be able to let this go? Is it stressful for you? If it's not stressful for you, continue doing it. But it will become a little bit more challenging because they're not going to be, at some point in the disease process, they're going to need more assistance dressing. Right? And if they need more assistance dressing, it means that they're going to need more assistance undressing, which also means that they'll need more help in the bathroom when they need to use the bathroom. So it becomes layers of more assistance.
So yeah, I have a question. At least they're getting to go to church. I'm at the place right now where he doesn't want to go. And I guess as the disease progresses, they kind of go inward and they don't even go into church.
Yeah, they don't want to go, and we still want to give them the option, right, that they can opt out. And that's kind of on us, right? Do you want to go to church? Oh, we have to do this. Oh, no, I don't want to. Right? To me, it's kind of like somebody gives me the option of doing geometry or playing on my computer. I'm going to play on my computer. Right? Or somebody says, hey, do you want to come down to San Jose for my 3-year-old's birthday party? And I live in Santa Rosa. I'm like, yeah, no. Right? No. Maybe if they were 10, because all I'm thinking was 3.5 hours and they're 3-year-olds, no. Here's your Amazon gift card, right? So they're giving me an option of like, do I want to do something? Hey, Heather, can you come and do this for me? Okay. Right? When I feel like I don't have any other choice but to say yes, then I'm going to say yes. It's kind of like going to the doctor's, right? Oh, we have a doctor's appointment next week. Right, for your loved one. Oh, I made this doctor's appointment. Oh, we're going next week. You risk them saying, for the next 6 days, when's the doctor? I don't want to go. Why are we going? There's nothing wrong with me. Right? And so you build up this anxiety around it. As opposed to on the day the doctor is going, oh my God, I totally forgot we have a doctor's appointment. I'm really sorry. Or, even better yet, oh, let's go get some ice cream, and you're in your car, and you're heading toward the doctor's, you're like, oh my God, I totally forgot we had to go to the doctor's, right? So you're not really giving them any time to opt out, right? I know on the weekends, at least this weekend for me, I'm not going anywhere, right? Because I've circumnavigated the Bay Area this week, right? And so I'm excited, and if I don't have to do anything, I don't have to get dressed, and I can sit on my couch, right, and watch TV or read a book or garden or, you know, I have choices of doing something or not doing something. So you want to, you know, kind of, this goes more towards dealing with difficult behaviors, entirely different conversation, but you want to limit options and sometimes not give them options. Like this woman said around, oh, that looks so lovely on you, you look handsome, you look great. You're not really giving them a choice. You're kind of pushing your choice on them. So I'm running out of time. I think we talked a little bit about a lot of different techniques, but with dressing, you don't want to rush the person. If you want to lay out clothes for them, again, limit the options, clothing options for them to choose from. But let's talk about bathing. I have about 5 more minutes. Because this seems to be the big thing. Now, who has bathing problems? How many times do you want your loved one to bathe? Sure, yes.
Well, once every other day, every 3 days.
Once every 3 days? Was there a time that you were fighting that they need to bathe every day?
Usually in the evening.
Okay.
They were. Yeah.
They were, and that's what you would really, really like. Have to deal with. So it's easier, but you would prefer them to bathe every day?
Well, maybe not every day, but every other day.
Every other day.
Right now it's once a week.
Once a week?
That's not enough.
Okay, once a week. How many people have more than once a week that the person's bathing? Okay. You're winning. You're winning the battle. How many are more than 3 times a week? Winner. And you also have caregivers doing it. Cheater. No, it comes down to, it becomes a safety issue. It's a hygiene issue and a safety issue. But it also becomes, I don't need to battle this. If I have the means to have somebody come in and help me with this, then I highly recommend doing that. Now, bathing is an intimate activity. Right? You have to lead somebody else up to bathing. Right? If you already have somebody confused, right, and you're coming in there and saying, take off your clothes, and you're starting to strip them down and getting them in the shower, I'd probably kick back. I would fight back too if I'm already confused to begin with. Right? So having that extra help is important. Also, limiting your expectations on, okay, do they really need to stand underneath the shower twice a week, 3 times a week? Okay, no. Especially if you're back and forth arguing with them about it. It might not be a battle that you want to do every other day, right? So if you can get them in there at least once a week, right, and maybe, just maybe, you can use soft toilets to help them. They have soapless shampoos that you can use. There's lots of other devices and items that you can use to help with the bathing that they're not even getting in the shower. There's a lot of fear in the bathroom, right? I remember I broke my ankle and I had a step-in shower or step-in tub shower combo, and I was really nervous stepping into the bathtub. And I still get a little nervous in the bathtub because I don't feel like I'm truly balanced in there. Right, but now I have a shower, I feel great about that. Maybe they turned on the hot water instead of the cold water and they burned themselves in the shower. Maybe they just don't know what to do once they're in there. Right? So whatever you can do environmentally can be very helpful in the shower, in the bathroom, but also maybe lowering some of your expectations on, you know, maybe every other day is not the best time or best number. And I'm not picking on you around that. Every other day would be great. If you are going to bathe, I'd pick, the morning overnight because the person's more alert. By the end of the day, they're more exhausted and it's just kind of harder for them to pull it together. But I'm not telling you not to bathe. If you can get them more than twice a week, that's great, because we want to be very careful with urinary tract infections and other illnesses. So we want to at least get them in there once a week. Twice a week, that would be great. But if you get them in there once a week, you're winning. So I'm running out of time. This was kind of my last piece. There's a lot of information on my slides for you. Do we have time for questions?